Hello and welcome to Dynaudio's Ask the Expert. I'm your host Christopher, and today we're going to talk about active crossovers. And to help us with that, we've brought in Roland. And Roland, can you talk a little bit about yourself?
Yes, I really think that Dynaudio makes the best loudspeakers on this planet, but would you believe it, not everyone knows about it. So my role in the Dynaudio Academy is to explain our loudspeakers, to introduce our technologies to music enthusiasts, to our dealers, to our distributors, basically worldwide.
Yeah, and I know you've just been to Australia.
Yes.
Yes, and I'm really envious on that trip. But without further ado, let's jump into the questions. Are you ready?
Let's go.
Perfect. Roland, our first question is from Jan, and he writes that he knows that the Fox XD and the Zero speakers, they are DSP-based. Mm-hmm. He wants to know, though, what actually makes them active?
Yes. As you know, every loudspeaker has to have a crossover. So that's to split the frequencies. So the tweeter receives the high frequencies, the mid-range, the mid, and the woofer, the bass.
Sure.
In a conventional system, this was all done in the analog domain. So an amplifier sends a full-range signal to a crossover, which is actually a filter network out of resistors, coils, and capacitors. So this receives the full range analog signal and splits the frequencies. Nowadays, most music sources and the music signal is in the digital domain. So it makes a lot of sense to keep the digital music signal and do this frequency split also in the digital domain. So in the Focus XD or in the Xeo, the crossover part actually looks like this. It's more a DSP. It's done fully in the digital domain. This is splitting the frequency, and it's much more accurate because of that. And now comes the active part of it. The active part is that after this frequency split in the digital domain, every amplifier powers an individual drive unit. So one amplifier for the tweeter, one amplifier for the woofer, one for the mids. And this makes the crossover both digital and also active.
Perfect. As usual, Roland, when we ask for questions, we get a lot of the same ones. And this time it's Chris, it's Alexandros, and it's Jesper, who asks sort of similar questions. And the essence of them was, why are we changing to active speakers and active crossovers?
Yeah. We're not really changing to active loudspeakers. We have a new contour range, and from that you can see we will always continue the passive, the traditional loudspeakers. And we make very good passive speakers. Yeah? So we take a lot of care in choosing the right components and making good filter designs. So we will continue with both. The Focus XD and the Zio are actually adding to our range.
Yeah, and that it is about adding new choices for our customers.
Yes, not everyone wants the same type of loudspeaker.
Precisely. The second part of that question, because there were two parts to it, is actually what is the benefit of using active crossovers compared to passive?
Yeah, it's a fair question because we make very good passive speakers. When you design a crossover filter, no matter how good you make it, you always affect the analog signal. There are always some side effects. And also all these components, they influence each other.
No.
So it's much more accurate to do this frequency split in the digital domain. You keep the music signal, which remember is digital anyway from most music sources. You keep it in the digital domain and it's much more accurate. And from then on comes the frequency split and the individual amplifiers. So yes, in a way, no matter how good you do it, it's better to do it in the digital way.
Okay. So, just to get this right, when we do it digitally, we keep the signal in the same domain for a longer time, right?
That's the key to it.
Yeah.
And then we bring it to the next level, which is why it is better, is if you split the frequencies and have individual power amplifiers for the tweeter, for the mid-range, for the woofer, then you really bring up a performance level. And that's these two elements make it actually better.
So in... Let's take a three-way Focus XD. You actually have three different amplifiers powering their own drive unit.
That's right. And we can specify the amplifier so it perfectly matches the drive unit. And the drive unit we make ourselves, so we know what's best for them.
And that's the benefit of it.
That's the benefit
to get
of
it right. Yeah.
And then you can make it actually better than a passive loudspeaker. because a passive loudspeaker has an external amplifier, and the amplifier and the loudspeaker, they don't know each other.
No. And that, of course, in our in active designs, we know the amplifier
exactly.
And we know the drive unit.
Yes.
Perfect. So, Roland, we have a question from Paul, and he's wondering if we've ever thought about integrating tone controls, for mm-hmm. example, to boost the high frequencies in our speakers, especially, as he writes, as it's nice to have a flat response when you have a flat hearing reception.
Okay. Well, Paul, the good news for you and the bad news for anyone else is no one has a flat hearing. So to start with, but yes, we added this in the Focus XD. The Focus XD has a little switch on the rear where it can tune the higher frequency response. So you can set it to neutral,
yeah.
Or you can set it to +1, so it slightly rises the high frequency.
Okay.
Or you can set it to -1, so there's a slight decrease in the high frequency. So you can tune it however you like the performance of the loudspeaker. And you can also tune it according to your room acoustics.
Okay.
So if you have a room which is slightly bright, you can also set it to -1 and have a better sound performance in your room.
Okay. Because one of the things that when you say that you can set it in +1 or -1 or in neutral, one of the things that I automatically start to think about is, okay, so what would I hear if I put it in +1?
The way we design it is that it not just increases the high frequency, but it's a tilt filter.
Okay.
So it actually gives a slightly more open sound, slightly more, you could say, brighter.
Okay.
But it's all done in the digital domain. That's the key thing here. So whatever we've done to the tuning of the high frequency, it's done in the DSP. So it's done without any side effects. Remember the old analog treble control on the amplifier?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's doing more bad things than good things, actually.
Okay.
So we do it in the digital domain, and it just gives this slight rise or the slight decrease in the high frequencies in the digital domain.
Cool. Our next question is from Craig. And Roland, he's wondering if when we design our crossovers and when we tune them, if we go for a flat EQ or if we actually tune them to have a more pleasant sound.
Well, it's a good question because first of all, everyone thinks about a flat frequency response and that's what to achieve. There's more than that to making a good loudspeaker. Maybe you've seen the photos of our new measurement room, Jupiter, and we can really measure a lot of other things that has to be right, like the phase response, the impulse response, the sound radiation of the loudspeaker. So first of all, it's not only a flat response. There are many other things that have to be right. However, if something is not right and the measurements are okay, but it doesn't sound good and a piano doesn't sound like a piano, we rather go back into the R&D phase and find a solution that measures good and sounds good. So
Jupiter is actually a big, big benefit for us in that sense.
Definitely. But it only works with using our ears and the ears of our engineers. So that's a very important part of it. So it's both.
But when we talk about that, I start to think about, well, there's more to a loudspeaker than just the crossover, obviously. We have a speaker cabinet, we have drive units, and there's obviously even things that I'm not thinking about right now. So is it just about the crossover, or are we talking about all of these parts?
Yeah, just like Craig explains or asks, definitely we are coming from the drive unit side. We are not coming from the DSP side or from the crossover side. We make the woofers and the tweeters right first.
Okay.
That's where we're coming from. Then we make a very good cabinet design. The crossover, be it in the DSP digital domain or in the analog domain, comes very later stage.
Okay.
Because this is the music signal. The crossover, that's the music signal. And that should be, that could come at the last point, if possible.
Yeah. But we focus on actually bringing all of these things together to build a good loudspeaker in the end.
Exactly, and that's the key to better performance. If you do all the things right, then you really get a much, much better loudspeaker.
Perfect. So we have a question from a Mr. Fingerhut, and I must say, Roland, that's a cool name. But if we get back to his question, he wants to know, when you have a speaker in a suboptimal position, as I guess a lot of people do, yeah, is there actually anything that we can do via DSP or crossovers to neutralize the effects of that suboptimal position?
Yes, actually, the room of Mr. Fingerhut is quite common. Mm. In the ideal world, you would place the speaker far away from the walls, so far away from the rear wall, far away from the side walls, to get the best sound performance. Mm. In the real world, in a normal living room, this is not really possible. Most people have to place the speaker closer to the rear wall. And everyone knows what happens then. You get an exaggerated bass, you get a lot of bass boom. And in the Focus XD, we've implemented a room position, speaker position equalizing, which affects only the frequencies that lead to these problems. Mm. So rather than just killing off all the bass, what we've done in the DSP is, by using this setting, the frequencies, I call them problem frequencies, are reduced, which is generally around 80 hertz, so 70, 80, 90 hertz. These are the problems, these are the frequencies that make all the problems, whereas the low bass is not so much affected.
Okay, and we can take that into consideration in the DSP?
In the DSP, that's the good thing. You remember, again, the bass control on the old amplifier, that's probably handling all the wrong frequencies.
Okay.
Because that bass treble rotary knob doesn't even know what the problems are.
No.
So you're just reducing the bass, which is not the key to, or this is not the solution. The solution is to know about what actually happens when you move the speaker to the rear wall. And our engineers measured what's going on. When we have some clever guys who know all the things about room acoustics and about how to do or implement that in the DSP.
And so we measure to find those, you called them problem frequencies, and then we use clever people that can develop algorithms to exactly reduce or boost or whatever it's needed to.
That's exactly what we've done.
Okay. Perfect.
Yeah.
The second part of Mr. Fingerhut's question is regarding the new firmware we did for the Focus XD. Can you talk a little bit about what we did with it?
Basically, it has the same function. So we have the speaker position EQ again, but the DSP has much more headroom and power.
So we can do better calculations.
Exactly. So we implemented even better or even more accurate equalization of what happens and what is the solution to these problems. So it's not only reducing the frequencies, we also took into account some phase issues and some other frequencies. So yeah, it works even better. It's even more accurate.
Perfect. So Bill, you sent us a question, and it's about what has greater impact. Is it the fact that we are using active crossovers, or is it the fact that there's no circuitry between the power output and the voice coils?
Well, it's both. In a conventional system, the amplifier is a relatively stupid machine. It just sends out the music signal to the loudspeaker, and there is no real interaction. The amplifier designer didn't know about the crossover, about the loudspeaker, and we don't know which amplifier is going to use with our loudspeakers. So it's not really a good match. And having a more direct link between the amplifier and the drive unit, as we do in the Focus XD and the Zio, it's just a great benefit.
So Bill, it's a bit of both. Okay, the next question, Roland, is from Joshua, and he wants to know if active speakers or active crossovers, are they actually just short-term solutions to speakers with bad drivers?
Yeah, that's a fair question, because there are a few loudspeakers out there, actually a lot of loudspeakers out there, which work that way. It's very tempting to buy a cheap drive unit and then even out some shortcomings in the electronic way, so in the crossover or in the amplifier design, which leads to very average sound quality. So if you have some resonance in the drive unit, this should be taken care of in the drive unit and not suppressed in the electronic way in the music signal. So the way we work is that we first of all get the drive unit right, the woofers and the tweeter performance. And then we add a DSP-based crossover and amplification. So that's one of the rare cases where 1+1 is more than 2. You really get up the performance of both together.
Okay, so as we talked about earlier, it's really about combining a lot of good stuff.
Yes.
And then ending up with something that's...
And that's exactly what makes the Focus XD and the CO so good.
Perfect. So, Roland, we're at the end of the day. It's the last question, and it's from Maxwell. And he wants to know whether or not we are changing to only do digital speakers, or are we still going to make passive ones?
Yes, I think the new contour answers that one quite nicely. We will have excellent passive speakers as well. The Focus XD and the Zio are quite successful for Dynaudio because people like the performance and they still have less products in the living room, less hi-fi components. So from that, we take it that this is really the way to the future. On the other side, there are many people who like to buy a passive speaker and buy a certain amplifier. They love the sound of a Class A amp, of a tube amp, of certain speaker cables. And that's part of the hobby. And we will always make loudspeakers for these hi-fi systems. So the future lies in both, yes.
I think that's perfect. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but we truly appreciate all of your wonderful questions and for you to take the time out of your day and send them to us. Roland, thank you so much for joining us today.
Welcome, it was really good.
Yeah, and see you next time.